by their threats. They didn't seem to listen to what they just said about being quiet. In fact, by inference, what Peter says here in verse 19, does your edict here conform to God's law? God orders us to speak, and yet you say no when God says to speak? Put away your technicalities, and that, is it right or wrong? So Peter nails them. Verse 20, just as the Old Testament's had, and Old Testament prophets had to speak, lift up your voice and cry aloud, the Old Testament prophets did, we must also. This is a moral imperative. This is a moral necessity. It's laid upon us. We've got to speak what we've seen and we've heard. Verse 21, the Sanhedrin were fearful, but not because of what Peter said. They were fearful of the people. They were fearful of what the people might say and do. They were praising out. They could hear the people out on the Temple Mount. They're praising God out there. Oh, for heaven's sake. This is getting worse and worse. They were praising God for all these things. They found no pretext with which they could punish them. Did you have to do that miracle in public? But they did it in public. So too many knew about this. We can't bring up false charges because everyone saw him being healed, for crying out loud. So no one could doubt the miracle. And he's more than 40 years old, and they've seen him there for four decades. It's kind of hard to hide this in the corner. And he'd never walked before. Men ignore, curse, or adore that name, that beautiful name. Ignore it, curse it, or adore it. I hope you adore it, my friend. What's your choice? Multiple choice. What's your choice? I hope you adore him. When man's law and God's law conflict, we are mandated to obey God's law. And then humbly and sincerely accept whatever persecution comes our way. That's our choice. I've got to object to laws which make us disobedient to God. Do what I can to change that law if I can. If we can be threatened and intimidated and silenced by religionists and by authorities, by definition, I'm not filled with the Holy Spirit. The business of the church is to approach the cripples at the gate who are excluded from worship because they're cripples. If you didn't have a perfect frame, you couldn't go in the temple. Put them on their feet. Make them worshipers. Opposition to Christianity will always be illogical. And when you witness to someone who's already got their heart fiercely against the Lord, they'll come up with some illogical statement or question. You need to be saved. Well, where'd Cain get his wife? Something like that. They'll come up with something. Even though the facts are before them, they'll oppose. Why? Because they're satanically blinded. That's why. And that's why we must pray for them, because they need help. We have no argument unless we can point to the healed man. In other words, has my life been transformed? If I'm living according to my lower nature, I better not witness to anybody. The Sanhedrin rejected Christ. They counted him as an itinerant teacher. They counted him as being a nobody. What's your judgment? I hope he's your God and Savior. He's not just a good man, as the liberals would say. He's a good man. No, no. He's the Prince of Glory. He's the chief cornerstone. When you know you're guilty, confess it and get it right. But these 71 men suspected, I think they suspected They crucified their Messiah, but they'd never admit it for pride and hardness of heart. And my friends, I don't know you like I'd like to, but may I say this, don't let pride and rebellion send you to hell. The church doesn't face Sadducees today. We face socialism, communism, materialism, carnality, worldliness, false religions, cults, hostile government, secularism, humanism, apostasy, electronic screens, and I could go on. What will win? Who will win? We're now in a deepening apostasy. And I hope you stand out head and shoulders for the Lord in this deepening apostasy. I hope everyone who knows you knows that you are a Bible-believing, obedient Christian. I witnessed to one lady, and we got into it about this, and she says, well, I'm not going to wear my belief on my sleeve. I said, well, why don't you? That'd be a good idea. In other words, I don't want to be embarrassed because I'm not really a Bible Christian. We're in a minority today, a distinct minority. And so there's a problem with that because there's a lot of believers who don't have a quality to their life following Christ. What we need is to be fiercely dedicated to Christ and his cause, publicly so, with our friends, relatives, neighbors, those who know us. If someone were to ask them about my testimony, I hope they would say, well, oh yeah, he's one of those nuts. I'd hope they'd say that. What would they say about you? Would you stand with me in prayer, please? May I have an instrumentalist, please? In just a moment, as the music plays, again, the old-fashioned invitation to an altar of prayer. Before a Savior who loves you, wants to help and bless you, wants to save your soul if that's your necessity, whatever your need, whatever your challenge, whatever your complication, he can solve all of those things. It could begin tonight. Father, help us now as we come to the end of our service, the old-fashioned altar. What a beautiful thing it is to have an altar of prayer. Draw us now, Lord, with thy cords of love. As we're on the knee of our heart, the knee of our body, bend down, Lord, condescend. Help us, Lord, we're guilty sinners. We surely need thy help. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.